this is a service that we do each year in honor and thanksgiving and in memory of those who have served in all the branches of our armed forces or who are continuing to serve. And so we're thankful that you can be part of that. And I want to say, that wasn't me. I especially want to thank the Girl Scouts of Troops 41170 and 40513. And you'll be seeing them as they participate. They're a very important part of our service. Thanks to Jim Gaglis, who will be reading the part that we had that we do each year in remembrance and thoughts of those who are POWs and MIAs. And to Tom Lecker and Christine Westman, who will be playing trumpets today. And also I want to thank Scott Marshall, who is very involved with his service, and Paul and the choir all put forth effort to make this be a very special day. We will be having a fellowship time in our fellowship hall afterwards. We invite you to join us for that time, which is special. At our church, we do carrying letters, and they're on a table in the foyer area. We ask that you sign those letters when you leave, and our letters will be going to those who are serving in the armed forces. And so if you would be sure, we have a listing of those persons, and if you'll be sure to sign those as you leave. Thanks to Bev Ackwoody, who will be serving as our liturgist, and you'll see these quilts that are on our altar rails in front. Those have been made by the peacemakers, and they will be taken to the VA hospital. And so on this day, we display them, and that's part of reaching out to those who are at the VA hospital. There will not be Sunday school today. You'll see a notice about meetings that will take place tomorrow and this pastoral search committee on Wednesday. And next Sunday afternoon will be our ecumenical Thanksgiving worship service. That will be at St. James Episcopal Church at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Just a reminder about Operation Christmas Child. And if you haven't gotten a shoebox, there are plenty of shoeboxes downstairs. Next Sunday, if you'll bring them, and we'll have a blessing for them, and then they will be sent to children in other places of the world. And also, we've been aware of the tragic events that have taken place in the Philippines with the storm devastation from the typhoon that is there. And so next Sunday and the following Sunday, we will be taking love offering that will go for the relief efforts that are there in the Philippines. You've been hearing the news, and the death toll continues to rise, and the devastation is really, really something. Just a reminder also that on December the 8th will be our congregational meeting for the purpose of discussing and approving the 2014 budget. There are some other announcements in there, but if you please take note of those. Any other announcements that should be made? If not, then we're going to take a moment, and I want to ask you to stand and greet one another. I encourage you to say encouraging things to one another.
Everybody,
today.
Good morning.
Let's greet and welcome each other.
Thank you.
Glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah. died to make men holy. Let us live to make men free. What God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. What God is marching on.
Color Guard, present the colors. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag and Christian flag. The words are printed in the bold. I pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands. One Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe.
Now will you join with me in our call to worship? We come before God to honor and celebrate those who in the past have given of themselves in serving our country, as well as those who are actively serving at the present time.
We give thanks for their willingness to give of themselves for the cause of freedom, to put themselves at risk so they might continue to live in the beauty and wonder of freedom.
As we enter into worship today, we remember that there are those who have given their lives so that we can have this opportunity and privilege.
Those who have suffered injury and loss for each of us.
We've all been affected and changed by the world wars and combat in Korea, in Vietnam, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, as well as elsewhere in the world.
All of us are in need of reflection, renewal, comfort, and healing.
Today, let us truly worship the God of peace and hope, the one who offers eternal life and freedom in his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, as we come here this day, we're mindful of the fact that there are those whose citizenship is here in this country who have heard the call to duty and are serving not only on the soils of our land, but in many other countries as well. Not only for the cause of freedom for us as we live here, but also for peoples in other places of the world. And so, Lord, today, our minds and hearts are lifting them up to you, and pray that as we worship you here, that they would sense your love and care for them, your protective hand around them, the strength that you provide, and the hope and promise that comes only in you. Bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Color Guard, post the colors. Color Guard, honor the colors. Color Guard dismissed. Please be seated.
now at this time of our service, the songs and hymns of the various branches of the armed forces will be played as their flag is carried forward. If you serve in one of those branches, would you please rise as that flag is brought down? Please be seated.
Those who have served and those who currently serving in the armed uniformed services of the United States are ever mindful that the sweetness of enduring peace has always been tainted by the bitterness of personal sacrifice. We are compelled to never forget that while we enjoy our daily pleasures, there are others who have endured and may still be enduring the agonies of pain, deprivation, and internment. We call your attention to this small table. It is set for one, symbolizing the fact that members of our armed forces are missing from our ranks. They're referred to as POWs and MIAs. We call them comrades. They are unable to be with us, with their loved ones and families, so we join together to pay our humble tribute to them and bear witness to their continued absence. This table is set for one, is small, symbolizing the frailty of one prisoner alone against his or her suppressors. The tablecloth is white, symbolic of the purity of their intentions to respond to their country's call to arms. The single red rose in the vase signifies the blood that many have shed and sacrificed to ensure the freedom of our beloved United States of America. This rose also reminds us of the family and friends of our missing comrades who keep faith while awaiting their return. The yellow ribbon on the vase represents the yellow ribbons worn on the lapels of thousands who demand with unyielding determination a proper accounting for the comrades who are not among us today. A slice of lemon on the plate reminds us of their bitter fate. The salt sprinkled on the plate reminds us of the countless fallen tears of families as they wait. The glass is inverted. They cannot toast with us this day. The chair is empty. They are not here. The candle is reminiscent of the light of hope which lives in our hearts to illuminate their way home, away from their captors, to the open arms of a grateful nation. Let us pray to God that all of our comrades will soon be back within our ranks. Let us remember and never forget their sacrifices. May God forever watch over them and protect them and their families.
Thank you.
National Anthem, courtesy of UCC, 552. Thank you. have to give unto you, to that which you purpose to accomplish in this world, in and through us, as we seek to proclaim the truth of what you've done for us in your Son Jesus, who gave of himself for each of us. Thank you now for these gifts in Jesus' name. Gracious God, in these moments I ask that you speak to every one of us here, no matter what our age. That you, through your Spirit, would open our ears to hear that which you would say to us. That you would open our eyes to see the truth in our hearts, the center of our will, to move forward and act upon that truth in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I always look forward to this time because it's a joy and privilege and honor and something that I think is entirely what we should be doing, to take time on a Sunday morning worship to give thanks and honor those who have served, those who are serving, those in the past who have served, many of whom are here with us this morning, those who went to fields of battle in foreign soils and didn't return, memories of those who once have been a part of life here, as I think even in our present day, there are children whose fathers or mothers are not coming home because their lives have been taken. So we honor you and thank you and thank them. And I encourage you, if you see somebody in uniform, and I try to do this, to say thank you for serving our country. Remember what that meant for our son when he returned from Iraq, to just be moved by people who came up to say thanks. We are blessed to have those who are willing to serve and have served. We are blessed as a nation, aren't we? I could hardly sing. But today, as we were singing about our country and how blessed we are here, from our founding as a nation to this very day, it's clear that God has had his hand of blessing upon our nation. Just think about what God has done in us and through us. Through us, not only on this land and what has to do with each of us, but what God has done in the world, because we've been willing, when there have been those who are doing evil and horrendous things to other people, to be willing to stand in the gap and put lives at risk for the sake of others, not for the sake of domination. That's not been our agenda. But for the sake of freedom, we can be thankful for the freedom that we have to worship together here today. Freedom to grow and become the people that God would have us be. That freedom to make choices in our lives. Freedom to succeed or fail. God has blessed us materially, hasn't he? God has given us victory in conflicts with our enemies. God has protected us. God has guided us. And in so many other ways, God has blessed us. When we think about that, it's the invisible hand of God that we may not see that has been moving and working from the founding of this nation to bring blessing. That's what our troops have fought and given their lives for, and continue to give of themselves in service, not only for us, but for people around the world, that we might live in the blessedness of freedom. As you heard the scripture read this morning from Psalm 33 and verse 12, it says, Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And when you look at what the psalmist was writing about, it really had to do with the people of Israel, God's chosen people. But there is a greater truth here that I believe is being expressed that has to do with us and our nation today. What the psalmist is saying is that a nation that turns to God, a nation that depends upon God, that fears God, that puts God first, that honors God, that seeks his guidance and is obedient to him, is blessed. Blessed by a loving God who, by the way, delights in blessing us. God delights in pouring out his blessing. The Hebrew word for blessing, it means happy and prosperous and successful, straight, right, contented. All of those things that have to do with our understanding of what it truly means to be blessed. Let me remind us this morning that there are conditions for God's blessing. And the condition is that we honor him. We seek to be in the center of his will, that we are obedient to him and dependent upon him. Those are conditions. we must be careful not ever to assume God is always going to bless us. Let me share with you the words of a man who was chaplain of the United States Senate back in the 1940s. He died, by the way, at 46 years of age of a heart attack. Peter Marshall, who was the pastor of the New York Avenue Presbyterian Church, some of you here may remember that name. I want to share with you his words. He said, "Our nation, ours is a covenant nation. The only surviving nation on earth that had its origin in the determination of the founding fathers to establish a settlement to the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith. A covenant nation is one that recognizes its dependence upon God and its responsibility toward God. This nation was so born. God was recognized as a source of human rights. The Declaration of Independence says so. A covenant nation is one which recognizes that God and his purposes stand over and above the nation, that the highest role a nation can play is to reflect God's righteousness in national policy. That is what Roger Williams sought when he set up his settlement in Providence, Rhode Island. That is what William Penn was striving for after in Pennsylvania. That is what they wanted in Maryland when, in 1649, the Maryland Act of Toleration set it down in writing. That is what Thomas Jefferson was striving after when he wrote the Declaration of Independence. See, I believe with everything in me, that because of the vision and the faith of those who were founders of this nation, the foundation of this nation is why God has blessed us for all these years. However, we must be careful to not simply assume God's blessing. Let me remind us all that just as God can give his blessings and pour out his hand of blessing upon us, that he can withdraw his hand of blessing as well. It says in Psalm 33:10, "The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples." If anything is clear when we look at the history of the people of Israel, it was that there were times when they were obedient and they were following God, and God was blessing them, God was giving them victory in battles, God was giving them the promised land, but there was a time when they turned away from God and they began to worship idols. And God took back his hand of blessing. And in fact, he brought other nations to take them into captivity. The nations, the ones, that nation of Israel, his chosen people that he loved, and yet had turned away from him. It wasn't that God no longer had plans for them, because when they were in captivity, Jeremiah wrote in Jeremiah 29:11, God said, "I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." I believe God has purposes and plans for our nation. Psalm 33:11, it says, "But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations." And God's ultimate plan for the world is not dependent on whether we're obedient to him or not, because God's plans are ultimately going to be fulfilled. Let me remind us all that our freedoms and blessings come not also because we have a strong military. Yes, God uses that and has used that. But let me remind you of what the psalmist wrote in Psalm 33:16. "No king is saved by the size of his army, No warrior escapes by his great strength. And while we're blessed to have military strength, and certainly that makes a difference and continues to make a difference in the world community, that is not the only key to our blessing. Our freedoms and blessing come because we truly live and function as a nation under God, under His guidance, under His strength, dependent upon Him. And as we all are aware, there continues to be threats to our freedom from outside of us. Terrorists, those who have that agenda to destroy us, lands and countries that are seeking to develop arsenals of nuclear weapons. But the threat to our freedom and blessings come also from within. They come from the actions that have been and continue to be taken by our Supreme Court, by the Congress, by judges and courts and states across our land, which are not only in opposition to our Christian faith and the godly principles upon which our nation was founded, but even more against God, the very one who has chosen to bless us. But let me add to that. In addition, the threat to our freedom and blessings come from the lives of our own citizens whose lifestyles, values, and priorities seem to be increasingly self-centered rather than God-centered, with seemingly no sense of fear and awe of God whatsoever. I want to tell you, it's painful for me to say this. My heart is grieved by what's happening in our nation. The message Reverend Billy Graham delivered is called his last call to America, My Hope in America. He said, "We have turned our back on God. We see the mess in Washington and all the problems that they're having. You haven't heard one person in Washington say, 'Time out, guys, let's get on our knees and let's call in the name of Almighty God and let's ask Him for help.'" I just want to go back to Peter Marshall, words that I believe could have been written today. He lived in the 1940s. He said, "Now this generation has distorted religious freedom to mean freedom from religion. We find our Supreme Court now declaring it's unconstitutional to teach our children that this nation was founded under God to His glory and for the advancement of the Christian faith, unconstitutional to include in the curriculum of our children's education any knowledge of God. Today, a large percentage of our population are without even a nominal connection with any church, children and young people entirely without religious training of any kind. But our children are souls," Peter Marshall wrote, "made in the image of God. These souls are immortal and will live forever, and the human brain is but a tool and an instrument which the human soul shall use. In the name of God, in the name of truth, teaching about faith must be demanded and provided for the children of today if this democracy and this civilization are to survive. The idea may be abroad in some quarters that democracy is a thing that must be preserved and that God is to be brought in as its servant. We must not get the cart before the horse. The plea of the church today is not that people shall call upon God to return to democracy and bless it, but rather that we shall together cause our democracy to return to God and be blessed." Let us remember, Peter Marshall wrote, that we are a republic under God. Let us remember that each of the metal coins we jingle in our pocket bears the inscription, in God we trust, is that just blasphemy? What does it mean to trust God? Certainly, no conception of trust in God can make any sense which assumes that He will prosper our ways to bless until our ways become His ways, until we begin to keep the conditions He has specifically laid down for national blessing. What does that mean for us? What does it mean for us sitting here today, honoring those who have given their very lives for this freedom that we have? Well, first of all, I think it has to do with us, that we honor and worship God in our own lives. That we seek Him first, that's what Matthew says in Matthew 6:33, but seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. That we live as His disciples. And if we do, then that means that we are salt in this society. Salt is a preservative. It does something to keep something in a condition that is not rotting. Disciples have always been called upon to be salt in their societies and to be light. Light in the darkness. It means, I believe, that we as Christians take stand on the issues and decisions that are made locally and nationally. And I'm sorry if this is offensive to some, but I've heard people say, well, the church shouldn't be involved in politics. I'll tell you, the enemy loves that. Our political leaders need to understand that there are people in this country who don't hold their same values. And the only way they're going to know that is when we voice it or we support those who are voicing those issues. Third, I believe that we pray fervently for this land, that there will be a turning back to God. Not any God, not a God that's created by humans, but the God. The God who of the Old and the New Testament, the God who created heavens and earth. That we support those who are risking their lives for the sake of freedom. And that we are the people of God that He has called us to be, you and I. And we as a church, we fully depend upon God. Will you pray with me? Oh, gracious God, as a servant of yours, Lord, I give you thanks for the myriad of ways that you have in your grace and love poured out your blessing upon us. I hear in my heart, God, your hands of love reaching out to each of us individually and to us as a nation to turn to you. I feel compelled, O God, to ask for your forgiveness. Those ways in which I or we have turned our backs on you, substituting materialism, that which satisfies our need, for true worship of who you are as the source of all things. God, today we do give thanks and honor those who give of themselves. Thank you for their willingness. Thank you for putting themselves, even as we are here this morning, at risk for the sake of freedom. Lord, I believe the greatest way that we can say thanks to them is that we live for you and are dependent upon you and follow you and live in the fullness and joy of the freedom not only purchased for us by their gifts, but even more that has come to us by your hand as you saw those who traversed across the oceans early for the sake of freedom to worship to these very lands. Those who had vision for this land to be a land in which they would not be dominated and controlled by government decisions, in which they would have the freedom to succeed and fail, the freedom to worship you as their conscience dictated, not as anyone else dictated. So, O God, I pray today that you would move and work in every single one of our minds and hearts, and that you would move in the hearts and minds of those who are our leaders, and that somehow you will move through your Holy Spirit in every church across this land and every individual across this land, Lord, and we will turn to you. Not so that democracy is maintained, but so that we're in a right relationship with you that means you supply all of our needs, and that somehow we find that blessing that comes from living in the center of your will and your purposes. All this we pray today, Lord, in the precious and holy name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand. Color guard, attention. Color guard, advance. Color guard, retrieve the colors.
Start again. just my children and my wife. Thank my lucky stars to be living here today. Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away.
God bless you, and we encourage you to go forth in silence today.